Hello again, this is Blaine McCormick at the Handkammer School of Business at Baylor University with a series on the financial statements in the Foundation Business Simulation. We're going to take a look at the balance sheet first because it's the oldest existing financial statement. It was created first. We have these that are hundreds and thousands of years old, so it was the first one created. And each financial statement in Foundation has a story behind it. And if you understand that story, reading the financial statement makes a lot more sense year to year or company to company. And so my goal is to help you see the story behind the balance sheet as you work with the Foundation Business Simulation. So let's start here with the accounting equation. That's what undergirds the balance sheet. And the accounting equation states that assets always equal liabilities plus owner's equity. Thus, the balance you have here, the equal sign, assets equal liabilities plus owner's equity, gives us the name the balance sheet. And this tells a simple story. This says that assets, which are your wealth-generating property or properties, that's why you have assets, so you can generate wealth over the long term. But your assets are funded with a mixture of debt and or equity. You have something and you bought it with some money, and that's what the equation kind of means in there. And we call debt and or equity capital, as in capitalism. And so, the balance sheet's really one of the undergirding foundational documents for capitalism because it tells you what your property is, and property rights matter in capitalism, and where you got your capital to purchase your property. So it's kind of all bundled in there in the capitalist story. I like to switch around the accounting equation, though, and it just made more sense to me this way because I think I'm putting the cart before the horse sometimes. I like to stack it up this way and say that liabilities plus owner's equity equals your assets, because this tells a slightly different story, but it helps you not put the cart before the horse. It says that your debt and or equity lets you purchase assets. And in the capitalist story, first you have to have capital and then you can purchase assets. And so this helped me understand why the balance sheet exists and how you can read it round to round or company to company and get the most out of it there. So this kind of frames up some of the big questions that the balance sheet answers for us, and that is, what kind of capital do you have and what did you buy with that capital? I mean, that's just kind of the two parts that we really need to know. Where'd you get your money? And how much it cost you, but that's a different story altogether. And then, what did you buy with it? Did you get some good things with it, or did you waste it? That's the balance sheet helps us answer that question there. And so here's a balance sheet, and I've just got it, some things to note on it. It's got a date on it. This is at the end of 2012. This is a round zero balance sheet. You can't see that. That's cut off, but it's a round zero balance sheet. And I've just got color-coded here. These are assets are in orange, and debt or liabilities are in blue, and equity or owner's equity is in green. So this is a round zero balance sheet, and we're just going to kind of go through it and see what we can learn from it. And I'll use we'll tackle the liabilities and owner's equity first, because assets are funded with a mixture of debt and equity. And so let's see what kind of debt this company brought in to round zero. If we go to page two of the fast track, we'll find that this company has three bonds. Every company begins a foundation with three bonds, and the first one is due in 2 years, the second one's due in 4 years, and the third one is due in 6 years in there. And if we add up the face value of these bonds, these were the size of the bonds, and this is when they're due, and this is the interest rate that you're paying on the bond, and this is where the bond is traded and evaluated or scored in there. But if we add up the face value here, we'll see that this is a 5.2 million in bonds, and they have 5.2 million in long-term debt, and so they funded a lot of it with debt and some of it with equity. We can see that they have, if we look on page two of the fast track, that they have 2 million shares of stock, and so these must have pre-existed around zero by some years. But you do inherit a company that has some equity funding and some debt funding in there. And if we look at the mix there, it's about 38, 40% debt, and about 61.5 or 60% equity in there. And that's just kind of the mix. We have that kind of money, and what do we buy with it? We'll ask that here soon. Let's look 4 years later in 2016 just to see how this changes here on liabilities and owner's equity. If we look at page two of the Fast Track, we'll note that they now have 2,030,856 shares. So in 2014, I just looked at the history. This company, they floated shares for to raise half a million in equity, and they did that, and so that kind of changed their common stock valuation on their balance sheet. But more so, they went and took a lot of debt. In fact, they quintupled their debt. In here, we can see that they've paid off two of their bonds, but that third bond is still there for 2018. It'll be paid off in a couple of years. And then as they got going, in 2013, they put out a 10-year bond. In 2014, they put out another 10-year bond. And so each round, they've put out some pretty significant bonds. And as a result, if we add all that up, we can see that they have a lot more long-term debt than they started with. In fact, if we look at their financial structure now, we can see that they're about 60% debt and about 40% equity. So they flipped that from the company that they inherited. So they've taken a lot of debt and a little bit of equity, and they're much bigger now, you can see. And so the question is, what did they buy with this? Well, let's go back to the round zero asset sheet, or part balance sheet, and the assets on that balance sheet. And we can see that it's a pretty simple story. The main thing that you have is a factory or plant and equipment with some accumulated depreciation there. So it's a little bit old, but it's worth about 9.6, or has a book value, I should say, of about $9.6 million there. And then you have some cash, some inventory, and some accounts receivable. And that pretty much is your asset base there. What you have in inventory and storage, and what you have in cash in the bank, and the money that your customers owe you in accounts receivable. That's a pretty simple story to tell in round zero. If we go 4 years later and see what this company had purchased, again, they quintupled their debt. And we can also learn that, their plant and equipment is a lot larger. Their fixed assets are about 3 to 4 times larger than they started with in round zero. But they've have taken out a lot of debt, and it looks like they've bought a lot of capacity with that. And their cash and inventory and accounts receivable, have gone up a little bit in there, not dramatically, nothing out of sorts there. So they're not what they're doing is they're taking capital and they're investing it into their plant and equipment. They're not necessarily investing it into their current assets there to help them manage that. So they're building wealth generating assets there, and that's a good thing. And so the question at this point comes up, is this a profitable operation? And now that we see what they have and how they financed it and where they got their money and what the obligations are for that money, we're gonna have to pay off some debts. We may owe our shareholders some dividends possibly. Is this a profitable operation? Well, we can't tell that using the balance sheet. That is why we have income statements. And so the next video that I suggest watching is the one about understanding the story behind the income statements in Foundation. But thanks for tuning in for this one.